quick recap, I have been working on restoring this carnival ride for the last few months. This is the King Supersonic Rocket Ride.
We pulled the main drive spindle here a while back and discovered some scoring and damage to the bearing surfaces. There's also a sleeve at the bottom that needs to come off. It's not supposed to be welded to this shaft. Now I've been trying to figure out how to fix these issues ever since. I got a lathe, but it can only swing a 13-inch diameter, and this shaft has a 24-inch diameter disc welded to the end. Then it occurred to me that if the shaft is long enough and my lathe bed is short enough, maybe I could just hang the disc off the end of the lathe. Only problem is, I don't have any way to support the shaft that far out. This lathe didn't come with a steady rest. Steady rests for my lathe show up for sale on eBay from time to time, but I've never needed one until now, and they always sold for more than what I was willing to spend for an accessory I didn't need. About that time, ads started popping up on Facebook for the services of a company called OSH Cut. It's a laser cutting service. I started designing a steady rest that could be made out of pieces cut from half-inch steel and bolted together, sort of laminated like plywood, except steel. I came across a limitation in the design due to the minimum size hole you could burn in half-inch steel, so I switched to using quarter-inch plate doubled up, although I didn't actually revise the drawing to reflect this change. As I got closer to the final design, I started printing out paper versions and used them to fine-tune the center point.
This is going to be a really expensive paperweight if I make a mistake.
This lathe is also missing the time machine functionality, or else I just don't know how to use it, which would have been real handy to know in advance whether this whole plan was going to work. I went through 48 design revisions over the course of a month before I was confident enough in my design to upload it to OSH Cut. OSH Cut has clearly invested a lot in their website to make the process painless. You upload your DXF files either one at a time or all at once, and the website analyzes your files. You then go through the files specifying the material you wish to use. My order was a mixture of quarter-inch and half-inch parts. Since I was using quarter-inch rather than the original half-inch plate, I had to go back through my order and specify twice as many pieces. If OSH Cut finds any problems, it'll flag the files and you can check whether they're just warnings or real showstoppers. Here the site is warning me about a potential for overheating the part. It also wanted me to know that it was recognizing two separate parts in some of my files, and this was correct. In the next step, OSH Cut analyzes the parts as a group and tries to nest the pieces to save you money over the original estimate. Speaking of money, I should point out here that I am in no way sponsored by OSH Cut. I found the site through their online advertising and I paid full price for these parts.
So a box arrived today that I am super excited about. I've been tracking its progress across the country for about a week now. These are the parts that I ordered from OSH Cut, and as you can see, the box is a little bit worse for wear. We actually arrived a day later than it was supposed to, and I'm wondering if it might have something to do with the way that box looks. Hopefully all the parts are actually in there. So it looks like all the parts are present and accounted for. The box, I think, is actually too big to ship these parts. It allowed for too much free space. Everything was just kind of in there flopping around. But fortunately, nothing was lost and nothing seems to be damaged. So it's time to start getting these things put together. So my plan here is to stack all these parts up, and what I want to do is cut 1/8-inch rod and pin them all together, hold them all in alignment, and then one by one, I'm going to drill those holes for a 1/4-inch bolt. So this is a tool that I built about 30 years ago when I was actively involved in the hobby of building kites. I used this for cutting carbon fiber tubing and fiberglass tubing. I built it around a design methodology that I learned from a NASA engineer called TLAR, and it has served me well throughout the years. Although this is probably the first time I've used it in 25 years, and it proves my point that I don't ever throw anything away. So the way I've set this up is a multi-step process, and there's probably a lot of different ways that I could have done this. For all reality, you could actually pin this together with steel pins and peen them over, and that would probably just be fine. But I wanted a way to be able to take it apart in the future, so I always intended to bolt it together. These holes in the plates, I'm really impressed with the accuracy of the laser cutting. I had set these all up as eighth inch holes, and so they're all pinned together with these eighth inch brass pins that I cut. And that holds everything in alignment as I drill through, because I want to make sure that I preserve that alignment. And if I were to drill these plates individually, I would fear that holes could drift in various directions, and when you go to put the stack all back together, they wouldn't line up properly. So this way I'm ensuring that I have straight through holes, and I also need to tap just one plate. So my steps through the process is I pin them all with eighth inch, then I drill them all through with a number 7 drill. That gives me my tap size. Once I have them all drilled, then I take the stack apart and I just tap the bottom plate, which in this case is the top plate. So it's just this plate that needs to be tapped quarter 20 all the way around. And then remove that plate from the stack and then re-drill all these for quarter inch through holes. So that gives me my alignment, and then as I do it, I keep replacing the pins. So once I drill the quarter inch, all of these come out and quarter inch pins drop in place until I have the whole stack up drilled. So it's kind of a laborious process, but I think it gives me the best results. Actually, I wouldn't say laborious, I would say tedious is the better word.
Comes up nice and even with the backside. I ended up doing a lot of test fitting, proving out the design as I went along. So I assembled and disassembled this thing far more than actually necessary. These two need to be drilled through holes yet. It's going to be a half inch, I believe. That's what I originally planned there. And this needs to be tapped for 3/8.
And again, I had ordered some 201 drill rod to make pins with, but it didn't come in time. So I'm just using some number 7 drills, the short stubbies. Just putting the masking tape on them so they don't fall through.
Now that I see how clean and accurate the holes are, I could have had all the through holes cut to finished size and saved myself a lot of drilling. As always, I will leave links down below in the video description to some of the tools and supplies I used throughout this project.
There's edges here that need to be cleaned up.
I turned a ball on the end of 3 half-inch bolts for the support finger adjusters. I used a combination of a form tool and a bit of just eyeballing it. This way I didn't need to tap a deep hole in each finger. So fully assembled, this steady rest weighs exactly 30 pounds. It's a pretty good chunk of steel. In addition to supporting the workpiece, I'm hoping that amount of mass will help to dampen any vibrations.
Good?
Yeah. I'm good.
Is it heavy?
How much higher do you need? Let me come back towards you. This needs to roll.
Yep.
More?
Yep.
Okay.
Yay, we did it!
Well, I do believe that's gonna work.
So this really couldn't have worked out much better. If my lathe had been longer, or that shaft had been either longer or shorter, or if that plate on the shaft had been bigger, none of this would have worked out. This project took me the better part of a month from beginning to end. In the beginning, I spent a lot of time looking at other shop-built steady rests, but all of them required welding, and welding is just not my forte. I also made some decisions so that I didn't have to tap any holes deeper than half an inch. The ad for OSH Cut came along just at the right time to prod my brain into thinking about making a steel sandwich type construction. A I'm not going to lie, I have a lot of money wrapped up in this thing. Probably about $600 just in parts. And that's fairly comparable, though, to what I've seen the OEM SteadyRest sell for, if not even more. And my SteadyRest actually has a greater capacity, so it's all relative. If I had access to a CNC plasma cutter, I could have saved myself a lot of money, but I have no complaints about the quality of the product I got from OSH Cut, and if in the future another project presents itself, I would not hesitate to use them again. And bingo. The next step is to create some tooling that's going to allow me to clean up the bearing at the top of the shaft. If you're new to the channel and you want to see how we got to this point or check out any of the other projects I've worked on, click one of those links to the left and come along for the ride.